You took the mattress with you, honey, when you went out through that ever-loving door. Well, I looked out of my window, saw you standing there. Well, I looked out of my window, babe, saw you standing, you were standing there. I didn't know you was a window cleaner, baby, till I see you standing there. Well, the woman I love, she's so big and fat and soft. The woman I love, she's so big and fat and soft. You know I gotta leave a chalk mark to show where I just left out. Well, I was talking and a-choking, and then to my surprise, I was hugging and a-choking and a-choking and hugging and a-choking and hugging and. Then, to my surprise, sixteen fellas with big balls of chalk coming round the other side. Well, she said, I want to feel the earth move when you make love, when you make love, when you make love to me. Feel the earth move, honey, when you make love, when you make love to me. I said, at this time of night, where you think I'm gonna find a JCB?
Thanks a lot. Thanks very much for coming tonight. I know you'll have gone to a great deal of trouble to get here. Some of you have come as far away as Headingley and Elmet, places like that, you know. Sherburn, you know, travelled a long way and a great deal of trouble you'll have gone to. Some of you will have got the babysitter in and they've got a little tray of sandwiches and a pot of coffee and some Coca-Colas and some crisps. Showed her how to work the remote on the television channel. Just about now, she'll have the boyfriend in. Another 5 minutes, she'll be lying on the hearthrug and he'll be pushing her across it. It's nice to know you're spreading happiness, isn't it, really, I think? And nice to know that your hearthrug is being used for something other than catching sparks. I was like looking around at an audience early on in the evening and seeing what you're like, you know. You can always tell the ones that have had a row on the way out tonight. You get the husband and wife sat there and they're not speaking to each other, staring glumly ahead. Usually because he's been ready for ages and she hasn't, you know. Come on, look at the bloody time. I've got to park the car and I want a pint. I'm not facing him so, but come on, be fair. Half an hour ago, you're banging on the bathroom door telling me to nip it off and hurry up. And he goes up and she's pulling a new pair of tights on with one hand and watering the plants with the other, you know. What are you changing your tights for now? The others were snagged. Well, it's dark in there. Who's going to see you, you daft bat? The answer is me. From where I'm stood here, I can see an awful lot in this theatre, I'll tell you. I see there's a lady over there with severely snagged tights. There's a bloke over there with his flies open. Zip them up, your brains will fall out. There's a lady right at the back up there, right in the gods, up in the ashtray there, with a beard. Oh, no, it's not. Keep your knees together. It's the angle. It's really steep. You know what those old theatres like? It's really steep. Look like a little goatee from down here. I tell you, you laugh, it's distracting stood here. You get loads of flashes of white knicker from the top up there, like a load of albino bats flapping around all over the place. And then there's the couple who've come together, so to speak, and he likes the sort of stuff I do, but she's not sure, you know, never seen me before. And by about 8:30, she's definite. She looks like she's been drinking battery acid. Then by 9:30, she's got a mouth like a hen's bum. Yes, good looking around here. Good. And there's the ones who brought the kids as well. That's always good. Because as the evening gets more Chaucerian, more ripe, the parents are sitting there going, oh, my God, how am I going to explain this to them? And the kids are sitting there going, oh, my God, how am I going to explain this to them when I get them home? It's 3 years since I've been on the road. It's a long time, longest time I've been off the road. I've been everywhere, India and the Himalayas and Nepal, doing all sorts of stuff. But 3 years, have we not lived through some historic times in the last 3 years? I don't remember 3 years in my life like it. She's gone, hasn't she? The bogey woman, the mad granny of Grantham, she went, didn't she? That was a very sudden job, wasn't it? Yeah. That many daggers in her back, she looked like a bloody hedgehog when she was going, didn't she? We're all out down our street going, ding dong, the witch is dead, the wicked witch is dead. Come on, Dorothy, get your red shoes on, we're on the yellow brick road, never mind. They were all crying in Grantham, you know. They were all crying in Grantham. Dead upset they were. They're frightened the bitch is going to go back and live there, I think. Interesting. People in Ilkley, like, not even smiling here tonight, are they? And what have we got in her stead? Let's be fair. What have they given us in her stead? Joe Bloody 90. Come on, there's a train spotter if ever I saw one. Let's be fair. He doesn't look right without the Adidas bag and the anorak and the little pad. Running down the station platform, writing numbers down. He don't look right. People say, don't be cruel to him. He looks decent and honest, that John Major. So does me greengrocer. I don't want him running the bloody country. And listen, I've got more right to be Prime Minister than John Major. I'll tell you why. I actually passed the examination to be a bus conductor. I was a bus conductor. I don't know if you know this, but he failed the bus conductor's examination. Truthfully, I'm not making it up. That's God's honest truth. That's what we've got running the country, a failed bus conductor. Draw your own conclusions. He's got one O-level, he can't remember what it's in. Do me a bloody favour. If you had one O-level, you'd never forget what the bugger was in. And I'll tell you what, I've been dished out some crap in my life, but that last election beat the lot. We got you into this recession so we can get you out of it. Great. That's like saying the bloke that's just beaten the shit out of you knows the way to hospital. What else has happened in the last 3 years? I don't know, little folk song for you here, little folk song. 'Twas 1843 on March the 18th day. We hoisted our colours to the top of the mast, and for Greenland we set sail, brave boys. Ooh. and for Greenland we set sail. Oh, the lookout up in the topmast stood with his spyglass in his hand. There's a whale, there's a whale, there's a whale. Shit, it's not, it's Robert Maxwell. He's not dead. He's not dead. He's not dead. He's in South America with Lord Luke, and I'm telling you, taking it in turns to ride Shergar. Salman Rushdie's run alongside going, me next, come on, me next. Now, what else happened in the last 3 years? Oh, we got a cheese plant. We've had it 3 years. We haven't had a single ounce of cheese off it in 3 years. Mind you, we haven't had a solitary Durex off the rubber plant either, so it's the way it goes. Tell you something else I've noticed in 3 years. You may have perceived this also. We're becoming more and more Americanized. The Coca-Colonization of our culture is almost there. All the American crap and garbage on television. We've got American junk food, the McDonald's burger chain. All the kids are going out for McDonald's burger parties. And the poor kids, shell suits, baseball caps, trainers with the tongs hanging out of the top. Little Americanos, aren't they, eh? Yeah. Watching The Simpsons on television. And all this TV advertised garbage that their brains are pulverised with every Christmas. Buy, 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 little consumers, turning them into it. I've decided, this last Christmas I said, I'm not going to get involved in all this. I'm going to renege on all this. I'm going to stand up and shout. I'm going to become grumpy old bugger number one. I am. I'm going to buy them the very presents I used to love getting when I was a little tiny like them. And I've got loads of nephews and nieces. So I bought each one of them, because I'm not tight, I bought each one of them a Rupert book, a rubber dagger, and a Mr. Potato Head. Brilliant. What a fantastic present that Mr. Potato Head was, wasn't it? I mean, you've got to get your own potato, fair enough. But you've got a selection of noses, eyes, glasses, ears, hands, legs, hats. Brilliant game. Stick them all in the potato, and there it was. And then when you got bored with it, you cook the potato and ate it. Fantastic. You can't eat a Game Boy Nintendo, can you? But what's the littlest one got? This creased me. The littlest one, Caroline, she's got a My Little Pony. She's driven them mad for a My Little Pony because of the TV advertising. My Little Pony, twinkle, twinkle, see it, dance, dance. Oh, buy me that, mummy. So they got it. Cost a fortune. Took me 8 worth of rubber that big with a tail and a mane. What a rip-off. Next Christmas, I'm buying her a My Little Pony abattoir. Bugger it, I'm going to get me on. Have you ever thought of this? This is what the brainwashing that goes on television, they actually sell that as a present in France. People buy that for kids in France. My Little Pony. They eat horses in France. That's like buying a kid in Leeds My Little Meat and Potato Pie. My Little Yorkshire Pudding with Gravy. My Little Rogan Josh with a tail sticking out of it. Ridiculous. I think there's one aspect in which childhood has not changed, though, I suppose, is that children still have that innate ability to wake up on that wonderful split-second timing, that wonderful hiatus, that pause, that cusp between foreplay and full rumpo. And they all know when that's happening. I don't know how they do it. They've got this inbuilt detector. Dad! What? Oh, shit. What? There's a monster in me bedroom. There's no such thing as monsters. Get back to sleep. There isn't. It's going to kill me. And anyway, I want to drink of water. Oh, shit. I do love you. I'm awfully sorry. Listen, carry on your own for a minute. I'll be back in a sec. And you pull your dressing gown on and go in. There's no such thing as monsters. Here's a glass of water. Get to sleep, you silly thing. And he's hanging on the end of the cot there. There wasn't. It was going to kill me. And anyway. Oh, Dad. Have you brought me a tube of Smarties in your dressing gown, Dad? Oh, that's for your mum. Now get to sleep. Don't be stupid. And that sleep thing's another thing. Children are selectively tired. Children are tired when they want to be. Go on, get your bicycle off the garden. Go on, bring it in now. Oh, I'm tired. Come on, get all this Lego together, put it back in your box and stick it under the bed. Oh, do I have to? I'm tired. Go and help your mum with the washing up. She's been busy all day. Go on, give her a hand. Oh, I'm really, really tired. Time for bed. I'm not tired. You can be not tired in bed. Come on, bed. Oh, I'm not tired. I'll get upset. I'll be lying there and I won't be able to sleep. And anyway, what time do you go to bed? Never mind what time I go to bed. It's time you think, hang about. Just one moment, I am not going to become the aggressive, smacky, shouty monster that my mum and dad were with me. I'm going to be the reconstructed new type parent. I'm going to reason with him. Even though he's only 4.5 years old, I'm going to talk with him reasonably and rationally as a human being, because after all, he is a small human being. Listen, there are children all over the world going to bed right now, you know.
Where?
Hong Kong, Tel Aviv, New York. He's got one of those bloody watches. 6 o'clock in the morning in Hong Kong, 7:45 in Tel Aviv, 10 o'clock in New York. I'm not going to bed. Okay, we've discussed this man to man. I, as the male side of the parenting bonded duality that are looking after you at this precise moment in your trip through the universe, have pointed out to you should go to bed. You said you're not tired. I took that on board, said you could be not tired in bed. You've pointed out to me the error of my ways vis-a-vis Greenwich Mean Time and time zones in other parts of the world. But still and all, as the male side of the parenting bonded duality that are looking after you, I feel you should go to bed right now.
Why?
Because if you don't, I'll rip your piggy head off. And you've failed. You've become the shouty, smacky monster. Don't feel too guilty about this, because we all do it from time to time. You know, it's not the right thing to do, but we do it. It's just human frailty, that's all it is. More than 50 times a day, seek counselling or run off and leave the little buggers. But otherwise, don't get too much of a guilt trip about the occasional lapse, because you will also find yourself becoming the fibby monster. When I was your age, I used to love cabbage. Sorry, even a three-year-old, they won't say it, but they're thinking, bollocks. It is a constant war. Children and adults, grown-ups and children, constant war to the death, the bitter death. It really is. Think about it. What's your mum's main job when you're little? Twofold. Keep you clean, throw your stuff away. That's her main job. You clean, stuff away. And every mum when I was a kid wore a pinny, big pinny around the neck, fastened around the back here. Huge thing. Mainly to stop stuff going on her, but mainly also so that wherever you were in the street, she could clean you up with that pinny. Even if she was miles away from water. Come here, you. What for? Look at your face. It's covered in jam. Mrs. Duffy gave me a jam butty and it squidged out and went all over my face. Come here. Spitting on a pinny and wiping your face. Oh, ma'am, don't wipe me face with spit, man. Oh, ma'am, don't. Keep still. Oh, ma'am. And I'm going out to school in the morning with loads of blonde curly hair in those days. Come here, look at your hair. You've not brushed it. I did. And it's not my fault if my hair's springy. Come here. She lick her hands, blast it all down. You're not going out looking like that. Used to call me the Gozhead kid in our street. And another job is to chuck your stuff away. Ma'am, where's all them beanos and dandies what I had under me bed? I threw them out.
Why?
They're full of diseases.
No, they wasn't. They just got Corky the cat and before the bear in them. There's no diseases in them.
I threw them out. I give them the bin, man.
Oh, that ain't fair. I don't throw your women's zonesies away, do I? I'm waking up to a cry in a minute now. Anyway, where's that jam jar full of frog's spawn what I left on the windowsill?
Oh, my God, is that what it was? I thought it was Swarfiggy. Dad's been trying to get grease off his hands with it for the last 2 hours. And children are innocently curious. This is another thing. They're particularly curious about their own bodies, because when they grow up, they realise there's bits and pieces on it that are, you know, fairly interesting. And my mate's wife was getting the little 3.5-year-old Daniel ready for his bath a couple of weeks back. And she pulls his little underpants down and discovers coloured felt-tip drawings all over his bum. There's a house, there's an aeroplane, there's stick people, there's a pussycat, you know. She said, who's done this on your bottom?
Gemma did it.
Gemma's his little friend, who's also 3.5, 4. He goes for the older women, you know. Oh, very good, and I suppose Gemma's mummy's going to have to scrub her bottom too, is she?
Yes, we was playing mummies and daddies.
Well, your daddy and I don't draw on each other's bottoms with felt tip.
Well, what are you doing when you're bumping up and down on a Sunday morning when I come in the bed?
That's got nothing to do with you. But it's got nothing to do with felt tips either. Now, shut up. And that was the end of it. She very wisely left it there. Now, as patterns of child rearing go, what a difference there is between that and me when I was 3.5 years old. Because if my mum had found biro on my bum when I was 3.5 years old, That would have been it. For a start, in an Irish Catholic household in Manchester, there would have been a gallon of holy water poured all over me. Then I would have been dragged down to our parish church of St. Dunstan the Aggressive in front of Father Riprap, and she would have said, "Father, I think he's in league with the devil. I've just found Biotto on his B-O-T-T-O-M, Father." And that would have been end of story. I'd have been sort of sat in his presbytery for about 15 hours while he lectured me, because sex was something you only did if you wanted babies. Other times you didn't do it, or if you did, it was known as an act of impurity and you had to confess it in confession. Even when you were 10 years old and just tiddling around with your wedger, that would have to be confessed as an act of impurity. And you'd go in like I did, 10 years old, and try and hide it in amongst a load of other sins that you'd made up, because you hadn't done that much that week, so you create a whole load of nonsense. "Bless me, Father, for I've sinned. It's 3 weeks since my last confession. Please, Father, I burnt down an orphanage, then I stole a blind man's money, then I got drunk and drove all the way down to Brighton, and I got in a big fight with 11 soldiers and killed them all, and I gambled millions and millions of pounds on the gambling machines, then I committed an act of impurity, then I killed another 10 soldiers, then I drove all the way back home, and I burnt down another orphanage, and I ate meat on Friday, and I was cheeky to me mum." This act of impurity now. Was it by yourself or with some other people? And it was totally innocent. How can this be a sin? Six of us, 10 years old, in our gang, the Green Hand Gang, measuring our willies with lollipop sticks. And there's one kid going, "Ha, ha." We should have told him to eat the ice lollipop first, you know, but, you know, oversight. Just forgot about it, you know. Made a right mess of the graph we were doing, I'll tell you. We kept getting different measurements off him, and there's a big dip in the graph in the middle like you weren't expecting. But then you grow up and you have children of your own, and I'll tell you what happens when you have your first child, your own child. You realise for the first time what infinity is. Infinity is that million light year gap between a little toddler falling down, banging himself, starting to cry, holding his breath and going rigid, and there's a million light years before he breathes again. "It's all right, Daddy's here, Daddy's here. Oh, come on, come on. Naughty chair, that naughty chair. What did it do? Smack that chair. We'll smack. Now, come on, this is doing you no good. Now, you're being silly. Now, come on, you know how to breathe. You remember. Now, don't be stupid. Now, you're being... Oh, no, come on, how old are you now? Come on, breathe. Come on. Come on now, come on, please breathe, please. God, make him breathe, please, God. I'll never get pissed again, God, please. I'll never watch that woman across the road getting undressed in the window again, God, please, God, come on. Oh, come on, come on, breathe, breathe. Don't you ever frighten me like that again." Oh, you worry yourself to death about them. It costs you a fortune. You feed them, you clothe them. It's the most expensive leg over you'll ever have in your life. And what happens? They're dangerous from the word go. When you're changing them, they pee on you. Little boys pee in your eyes. Little girls pee up your sleeve. Oh, God. You feed them. That's fraught with danger in the high chair. You've got the Farley's Rust, the hot milk, sugar. Come on, here's the big aeroplane. Open for the big, big aeroplane. Come on, there's a big girl. Come on, here's the aeroplane. Open wide. You get in, she sneezes on you. Covered in Farley's Rust and boogies all over the place. Oh. And that's the other thing. 2 o'clock in the morning, you're fast asleep. Moonlight streaming through the curtains. Something pokes you in the eye. You wake up and hanging onto the edge of the bed, no more than 18 inches from you, is the bubbly snot monster. He's got a cold and he can't sleep. "Dad, I can't breathe, Dad. I can't breathe, Dad." And they've all popped and gone all over his head and dried. He's shining silver in the moonlight. Ah! The creature from the Green Lagoon. What is it? Yeah, you suffer, you bleed for them. And what happens? They grow up and become adolescents. And they forget all that, don't they? Because when they're adolescents, you bore them and embarrass them. "Oh, Dad, you're not putting that moody blues album on the record player again. Dad, you're not going out in that cardigan. Mum, tell him, Mum. Oh, Dad, not sandals and socks, Dad. Nobody..." And this style king who's pointing out to you your sartorial inelegance is a punk with a day-glow circular saw stuck through his head. Then they grow up and they leave home, they get a house of their own, you go and visit them on a Sunday. Oh, Christ, my mum and dad, get them presents out they bought us for Christmas. Stick them on the mantelpiece, quick. Oh, God, they won't be here long, you'll be all right. Listen, if you've no other ambition in your life, it should be this. Live to be a burden to your children. Find out where the buggers live and plague them. Don't let them get away with it. When I'm 60, my ambition is to get a Harley Davidson motorbike, the full Monty with the Hells Angels bars out here. I'm going to get the bullhorns, I'm going to get the huge denims and the original leathers and all slashed and all covered in porridge and giblets, and I'm going to have a matted beard and grey hair all greasy and horrible. And when they're having a posh dinner party with their friends in the suburbs in their beautiful detached house on a summer's evening like tonight, I'm going to go tear arse in across the lawn. Straight up the front step. Straight through the front door and in. Off the bike. And see them all sitting there at the dinner table, stabbing themselves on the side of the head with forks. I'll go in and say, hello, you're fat, aren't you? Haven't you got a big nose? Are you the woman that's knocking him off and your husband doesn't know about it? Then I'm going to take all my clothes off, every mortal stitch, apart from my vest, which will only come as far as my belly button, and I'm going to stand there sucking my thumb and twirling my willy. I'm going to say, oh, Mark, will you wipe me bum? I've done a poo. Revenge, the name of the game. You've always got one ally when you're going through that. Maybe two if you're lucky. Your grandma and your granddad. Because they can love you mercilessly. They can spoil you. That's their job. That's what they're supposed to do. That's what they're there for. And I want to do this song now. A song by a little kid singing it to his own granddad. And it's a sort of love song, really. And I wrote it about my own granddad, Henry O'Neill, from Dublin. He used to spoil me rotten when I was a kid, which was his job. And the song's called Me and Granddad Are Mates. Grandad takes me fishing on a Saturday, me and Grandad's mates. Grandad brings me maggots, pink and yellow ones, and me hooks and weights. We sit all day, come rain and shine, on the banks of the old canal. Sometimes we seine out, other days we chat away, 'cause me and me Grandad's pals. Grandad takes me walking with his little dog, he calls her Jip. We go to the pub and Grandad has a pint of grog, gives me a sip. He says he drinks beer 'cause his legs are stiff, and it oils them and makes them supple. Sometimes I think it works too well, 'cause it doesn't half make him wobble. Grandad, he comes round and sits with me when Mum and Dad go out. We play snakes and ladders and Monopoly, Grandad has a bottle of stout. He lets me stay up till 10:30, and if Mum asks him what time, he made me go upstairs to bed, Grandad says 9:30. Grandad tells me all about the things he did when he was a lad. Grandad tells me all about the war and when days were bad. Sometimes he talks about me gran, and then he looks far away. He says she's been gone a long, long time, but he'll see her again someday. Grandad shows me tricks with pennies, Grandad flies me kites, Grandad brings me fish and chips home from the pub at night. And if ever I grow up and I get old, and my kids, they have kids, then I'll take them fishing, and I'll do all the other things that my granddad did. 'Cause my granddad takes me fishing on a Saturday, me and granddad's mates.
Grandad brings me maggots, pink and yellow ones, and me hooks and weights. We sit all day, come rain or shine, on the banks of the old canal. Sometimes we seine out, other days we chat away, cos me and Grandad's pals.
Come now for all you 60s hippie freaks out there, Cats. Wow, yeah, too much far out. Peace, man. Yeah, I was that guy. I was that soldier. I was the fellow with the red bandana round his head and the long hair and the caftan and the crushed velvet loon pants. Thong sandals. And the Afghan coat with all the embroidery that smelt of camel pee when it rained. The only trouble was I could never be a real crazed hippie freak because I couldn't do drugs. I still can't. Still couldn't smoke a cigarette. If you give me a cigarette, halfway down I'll go dizzy and be sick and fall over. Can't do it. The only drugs I can do nowadays are Boddington's Bitter, Tetley's Best, Theakston's Old Peculiar, stuff like that. But I have trouble getting it up my nose, do you? Yeah. I've had it coming down my nose loads of times, but I've had trouble getting it up, you know. And it's really weird, because you go to parties in those days, these hippie parties, you know, you'd sit there and they'd be passing a roll of wallpaper around, you know, they'd say, try that, man, Moroccan black, you know. Some good Nepalese green there, man. And I'd be sitting there with a bottle of Newcastle Brown, shaking it up and just sniffing the froth as it came out of the neck, you know. At one party, this fella came in, he said, hey, anybody want any magic mushrooms, ma'am? Well, I thought magic mushrooms just meant very good mushrooms, you know. Like, how you doing? Magic. See that goal of United's last week? Yeah, magic, wasn't it? You know. So I bought £4 and took them home to me, ma'am. I said, yeah, ma'am, there's some very good mushrooms here. And she made a wonderful cream of mushroom soup. And we ate it, you know, the whole family, big family I came from, we ate it. And I'll never forget my grandmother deep tongue kissing the parish priest. He's the Bishop of Galway now, you probably know about that. But my sister was the best. My sister took every mortal stitch off and she danced stark naked for 17 and a half hours in front of the television set in Dixon's window. Yeah. But the big buzzword in those days was Kathmandu. Everybody wanted to go to Kathmandu. Overland to Kathmandu, that was the big one. And I went to Kathmandu, yeah. It's 4 years ago. My mum wouldn't let me go till then, you know. But I went making a film for Channel 4. On the ecology of the Himalaya and just the way it was being affected by mass tourism and things like that. And people had warned me, a lot of climbers, mates of mine, had said, whatever you do, don't drink the water out of the taps of the hotel in Kathmandu because it's terrible stuff, it's all polluted. Because the sewers and the water supply run side by side and all the pipes are cracked so that the sewerage and the drinking water is virtually interchangeable in Kathmandu. And if you drink from a tap in even the best hotel in Kathmandu, you're almost guaranteed to be drinking somebody else's stool. Now, drinking your own isn't a lot of fun. I don't know if you've tried it, but somebody else's is a dead bloody liberty as far as I'm concerned. But I forgot, and I took 2 malaria tablets, and I put them in my mouth, and I thought, I've got to get some water out of the tap. 2 inches, no more than that. Threw it down my neck. 6 hours later, my bum turned into a colander. And for the next 3 weeks, nothing bigger than a current came out of there, I'll tell you. I got amoebic dysentery, something rotten. I lost 2.5 stone in 3 weeks. I was going to try and market this as the S-Plan diet, you know, that'd be good. Sort of liquid weight watchers, you know. And I went the entire distance. We went 280 miles to Everest Base Camp and back out again, through the jungle up into the glaciers and all the rest, and back out again in a permanent squatting position. Wasn't worth getting up, you know. People kept saying, his rucksack's too heavy, that bloke, is he? And at one place called Namche Bazaar, which is in the Khumbu Valley, just south of Everest Base Camp, at Namche Bazaar, I went 17 times in one night. On 3 occasions, I actually managed to get out of the sleeping bag. Which cheered me up a lot, I can tell you. And twice, I managed to get out of the tent. Which cheered up the blokes I was sharing it with. Well, you can imagine, you know, nearly a month of this sort of action. As I was on the walk out through the Himalayan jungle on the way back towards the roadhead at Jiria, I was conscious of the fact there was something severely wrong with the business end of my anatomy. Because every time I squatted down, it had started munching grass. And I noticed it was going for the biggest, coolest leaves it could find, you know. And it had also started whimpering, you know, when it heard the sound of my belt buckle being unleashed on my belt, you know, so it went, oh. And I thought, if I'm ever going to ride a bicycle again, I'm going to have to get this sorted out. There's a clinic in Kathmandu run by the volunteer organisation called CWEC, and it's run by a fellow called Dr. David Slim, who was the world authority on amoebic dysentery, in case you were interested. And all volunteer English and American doctors and nurses. And I went in and I said, David, I think I've got terrible trouble with the business end here. I said, because I've had dysentery for 3.5 weeks and it's been crippling me, but I said, I seriously think there's something wrong. Will you have a look? He said, sure. So I had to drop. There's no, I'll tell you what, there's no sort of nobility in this at all, is there, you know, no dignity. He said, just take your stuff out. I had to drop my trousers and my trolleys and sort of lie face down on this bed. And this very attractive English lady nurse holding the cheeks of my bum apart with her hands like that. And he's got a lamp on his head, a rubber glove on, and he's saying, And this nurse said, when's this programme on television in England then? And I don't normally have a conversation with people when they're holding the cheeks of my bum apart, you know. And I got the giggles because I suddenly saw how stupid this situation was. And also I thought of her phoning her mum and saying, Mum, you must catch this programme, it's on Kathmandu in Nepal, and this bloke's made this film over here. And the mum says, oh, great, I will, yeah. What does he look like? You know, and I'm giggling away there. I said, I'm sorry. And he said, it's all right, it's nothing to worry about. Anyway, he said, all you've got is an anal embolism. So I said, come on. I said, what's one of those? I can play the guitar and things like that. I said, I know nothing about medical terms. What is it? He said, well, basically, your bum's blowing bubbles. He said, it's done 5 years' work in 3 weeks and it's not very happy. He said, have you seen Louis Armstrong's lips? So he gave me some ointment and I took it back to the hotel and put it on and it caught fire. I had to get the pillow slip and beat it out, you know, and throw water on it. But still and all, by using this ointment and some crushed ice, which I bribed the houseboys to bring me on the hour every hour, I managed to get the contusion down so it was manageable. But I still hadn't got rid of the amoebic dysentery. Now, we had a lot more filming to do, and I'd worked it out that I could just about get 400 yards from the hotel, and I'd always be able to make it back in time to the cars. You know, there's a 400-yard force shield around this hotel beyond which I couldn't go. And I'd perfected the art of the 400-yard mince, you know, the sort of... Because it's a known medical fact that you cannot run and clench your sphincter muscles at the same time. It cannot be done. And one day we were filming 404 yards from the hotel. And there's a green-eyed yellow idol to the north of Kathmandu, you know, and I'm talking to camera, rolling, action, OK. Well, this is Ganesh, the elephant god, one of the most important gods in the Hindu pantheon. And if you look down here, you'll see he's riding on a mouse. Now, this is very common to find this. If you look... Oh! It's a wonderful film of me mincing my way through the Kathmandu traffic, the rickshaws and the flute sellers and the gourd sellers, you know. I got in the hotel, I'm going, easy, you've done it, brilliant, easy, oh, God in heaven. There were 300 Japanese tourists checking in at the reception. They've all got camcorders, Pentax Stoop, credit cards, segs, and they're all paying individually on Amex and having their impressions taken there, and then it's taking forever, and I'm stood at the back going, hello, hello, because it's a known medical fact that you cannot shout and clench your sphincter muscles at the same time. I tried it. Hello, I'm going, hello, hello, and this Japanese bloke said, what's the matter, you talk funny, Siri Perak? I said, very sick, my key, 1613, please. Ask them to get my key, 1613, please, sayonara, please. He went, in fact, I go, don't go, yamita, yamma, handi, hold on, yamma, ha. I said, thank you very much, sayonara. Mincing my way into the lift. The doors are just closing. 16 Japanese with camcorders and luggage raced across the lobby and jammed in with me like rush hour on the Tokyo Underground. and I cannot move. There's 17 of us in this lift, jammed in. I've got my finger on the button for the 16th floor, and the door's closed. I said, what floor do you want? I go 16. He said, I'll go 16. I'll go. Off we go. It was the slowest lift I've ever been in my life. And at the third floor, I coughed. It's a known medical fact. You cannot cough and clench your sphincter muscles at the same time. It's not possible. By the seventh floor, eight of them had fainted. By the ninth floor, I knew that the Japanese for whose shit is Sumo Fumonaki.
Oh, Sumo Fumonaki! Oh! Sumo Fumonaki!
And they're all jammed, nobody can move, the fainting ones are like that. They're going, Sumo Fumonaki! In the 16th floor, the doors opened, they all fell out in the lobby. And I was only glad as I stepped over these prostrate little Japanese people that I'd had the presence of mind to tuck me trousers in me boots before I left that morning. Well, this is my very first guitar. First guitar I ever got when I was a tiddler, this was. It was wooden all over originally. But you know how your mum could send your first pair of shoes away, your little tiny shoes, and have them chromium plated? Well, my mum sent this away and had it chromium plated. I'm used to keep it on the mantelpiece, but it rolled off and killed the cat. Cat's own fault for being in a cliche in the first place. It was on the mat, it should have known better. Do you know, they never got that in Guildford at all. We had to do the show twice for them in Guildford. Once so they heard it, the second time so they understood it. Seemed more life in a dog's pelt. No, this was my first guitar, and it's a lovely guitar for playing bottleneck blues on. You know, I want to do some bottleneck blues for you tonight, because obviously you're into the blues. And the bottleneck blues was invented, I don't know if you know this, it was invented by a bloke from Batley. Oh yeah, seriously, honestly, I'm not messing around. This bloke from Batley was a fantastic blues player, he was brilliant. Well, you not know this, that most of the great blues players of the world came from round here, you know. Oh, yeah, Jewsbury Black, you know. Cleck Eaton. Oh, I mean, the Cleck Eaton blues singers like, well, Howlin' Wolf, he was from Cleck Eaton. Sleepy John Estes, he was from Cleck Eaton. Blind Lemon Jefferson, he was from Cleck Eaton. Blind Lemon Meringue Pie, he was from Cleck Eaton. And Blind Lemon Meringue Pie had a brother called Deaf Apple Charlotte. Yeah, because disability and the blues ran in the family, you know. And it was Deaf Apple Charlotte who actually invented the bottleneck guitar playing style of music. It was while he was busking one day at Batley Conservative Club and starving to death slowly. And he bent down to pick up a bottle, and as he pulled it across the guitar, it caught on the neck. Now, I haven't got a bottle to show you, so I've only got this thing here. I do hope you can see it. That's my very first Vic inhaler. Mum had it chromium plated. You gotta be careful what you left lying around in our house, I'll tell you that for nothing. Oh, aye. First bed of underpants was a disaster, I'll tell you. Yeah. So he picks this bottle up, picture this, you know, come with me in your imagination. He picks the bottle up, catches on the guitar strings, and makes a really weird noise, and he goes, oh. I've got an idea, he said. We can give a guitar away with every bottle. And they did. For years, people would come out and they'd find three bottles of milk on the floor and three guitars. And they got fed up because they didn't know what to do with them. They made fences out of them. They played bat and ball with them. They kept hamsters down the hole in the middle, you know. Sliced hard-boiled eggs on the string for the picnics, you know. But they got fed up in the end. There was a glut. The houses were full of old guitars. They said, listen, to his mates, you go and have a word with him, Deaf Apple. You tell him to knock it on the head with the bottleneck and the guitar and all that business. So they went along and they said, hey. And he went. So they got a big piece of 4x2 and smacked him on the head to attract his attention. And they said, hey, knock it on the head with the bottleneck. He said, what? He said, pack in. Oh my God, listen, use your plectrum. Well, they didn't call him Deaf Apple Charlotte for nothing.
He took his trousers and his underpants off and straddled the guitar and slid up and down it, making sort of really weird sort of noises, some of them with the guitar, and he did this for about 3 months and whimpered a lot, and his mates came back and saw him and said, "You deaf apple Charlotte, not your rectum, your bum pot, your plectrum." He said, "What? What?" Oh, they said, "Listen, use your pick, man." Hey, you folks are well ahead of me here tonight. Yeah. Yeah, he misheard them completely, and undoing his zip, he earned himself the final accolade by which we all know him and love him, Howling Deaf Apple Charlotte. So this is a Howling Deaf Apple Charlotte number from Cleckheaton I'm going to do for you now. It dates from the times when he was working on the Leeds trams. He was a Leeds tram driver, you know, the big wheel on the front there. And you remember the thick fogs we used to get years and years ago in the north, like these massive pea soupers? Well, in one of those fogs, he got lost, you know, driving this tram. And he ended up in Portugal, you know. And some of the people were very upset because they were going to be late for work, they knew. 2.5 years late, they knew. And he got some earache off them, he really did. So he jumped tram in Portugal and he got a job working in a sardine canning factory, which is where this song comes from, because he hated it. He wrote the sardine canning blues when he was there. He hated it because he was not a cruel man. No, he wasn't. And they made him do really wicked things to these sardines. They gave him a little whip about 2 inches long, and he had to whip these sardines and make them all line up dead tight and close together like that. And then they all had to fall back in the cans at the same time, go on like that, you know. And he hated it. So he wrote this piece of music I'm going to do for you now, called Sardina, which of course is Portuguese for sardines. And I think it's deeply romantic to think of this song having gone all the way from Cleckheaton to Portugal and then come back all the way again to West Yorkshire. You don't give a chuff, do you? This is like juggling with 40 pound of loose soot, I tell you what. More chance, platin fog. Oh, well, I'm going to do the bugger anyway, I'm not bothered. Right, here we go. Sardina. I'm really inspired now, I can tell you. Are you ready, fingers? Okay. But either laugh with the others or bugger off home. Can't stand individualism. Here we go.
Sardina cowboy in Rochdale, spurs don't fit right on me clogs. Sardina cowboy in Rochdale, cause people laugh when I ride past an RR station door. Almost every night there's a tripe and cow he'll fight in our local pie and pea saloon. And poor old Uncle Fred spent 18 months in bed as he tried to kiss a girl who's a boy called Sue. And sardine a cowboy in Rochdale, spurs don't fit right on McLeod, should low D. Sard being a cowboy in Rochdale, 'cause people laugh when I ride past the narrow station door. When the sun shines in the west, that's the time that I like best. I go out punching cows with me brother Jack. And poor old Uncle Fred spent 18 months in bed, 'cause he punched one cow and she went and punched him back. And sard being a cowboy in Rochdale, spurs don't fit right on McLeod, should low D. Sardine a cowboy in Rochdale, people laugh when I ride past the narrow station door. At the local temperance bar, we go and have a jar, the sarsaparilla and licorice juice to drink. And poor old Uncle Fred spent 18 months in bed, 'cause he sucked the stuff they used to clean the sink. And sardine a cowboy in Rochdale, spurs don't fit right on McLeod, should low D. Sardine a cowboy in Rochdale, 'cause people laugh when I ride past the narrow station door. You know, when us cowpokes hit town, we go and we horse around with them good time girls in the house of Mucky Peg. When Auntie Kitty found Uncle Fred, he spent 18 months in bed, 'cause you can't run fast with your pants halfway down your legs. Sardine a cowboy in Rochdale, spurs don't fit right on McLeod, should low D. Sardine a cowboy in Rochdale, 'cause people laugh when I ride past on our station door.
Yee-haw! I don't know what you were like going through puberty. I hated it. I think it was the worst thing I've ever been through. It must be a horrible time for everybody. You've got to buy your first bra, you've got to shave for the first time, all that sort of stuff, yeah? Yeah, I stood there having a shave. My mum came in. She said, "What are you doing with the bra on you, daft bugger?" I thought, I had to wear one. Now I'm 14. "Get it off, you plank," she said. "Anyway, it's your dad's. Go and put it back in the drawer." You know, you know your mum's main job when you're growing up through puberty is to embarrass you. You know that, don't you? That's her main job, is to make you feel really, really stupid. Well, the first time I took a girl home to our house, we're sitting there in the kitchen having a cup of tea. What did my mum do? Starts ironing my dad's underpants. She's holding up these huge baggy wide fronts and she's going, "I don't know how you get these marks on the back of these, Ronald. I've no idea at all. Sliding down rusty scaffolding at work or something. I've no bloody idea. Can't get rid of them. I've tried everything." And then, only a woman can do this to another woman. Only a woman knows how to say something as cruel as this and yet do it so subtly. "Are you are Michael's new girlfriend then?"
"Yes."
"You used to have a nice girlfriend, are Michael?" "What?" And I took this girl to the pictures that night. Now, I don't want this to sound sexist, because it was the 60s. We didn't know much about anything in those days. And my mates had said things to me about her, because she had a huge pair of bosoms. And I was only 14 and a half, and they kept saying, "All that meat and no gravy, get stuck in there, go on." And I didn't know what they meant. So he's stuck in, they said, "Get forward." So I'm in the pictures there, and I just put my hand down her blouse. I didn't know what I was doing. I was just led on by my body. And I put my hand down, and I thought, "Hey, up, she's got a hairy chest." And I'm pulling out yards of cotton wool, and her bosoms went, gone. But I'll tell you what, I freaked out, because I thought, "She's not real, I've got her stuffed in, what's going on?" Threw me completely. And then she started kissing me. I'll tell you what, she made up in passion what she lacked in bosoms, because she started kissing me on my lips and went down to my neck, and she's sucking really hard. She's going... I thought, poor girl, she's starving. I said, "I'll get you some popcorn. Hang on a minute, I'll get you some popcorn." But she went all around my neck. I ended up with love bites all around my neck. Shally rash, they used to call them when I was a kid. All the people came back from Butlins covered in them. And I've got a neck like a doner kebab when I'm going out of the picture. And I thought, my mum sees this, Irish Catholic family, she'd go, "Barmy." So I've got my collar up and trying to hide it going in that night. "Hello, mum. Hello, dad. Going to bed."
Come here.
What's up?
Never mind what's up. What's the matter with you? Nothing. I've seen a great picture. Brilliant. What's that on your neck? Me head. That mark on your neck.
Oh, that, yes,
I was going to tell you about that. I was walking past this old man and he sneezed and his false teeth shot out and caught me on the neck. On the other side, I was coming up the lobby and I fell over on the Hoover and it switched on and the tube got stuck in my neck and I kept pulling it off, ma'am. Ma'am, I'm nearly 40 and a half years old. You've known me all this time. You've never noticed these love bites before. I find that very unusual, mother. Come here. What for? I'm going to bed. I'm tired. Come here. What? Come here. Get to bed. You're not so big I can't give you a damn good hiding. And for 3 weeks, you know what she made me do? She made me wear Valderma spot cream all over me neck. You remember that, the skin-coloured cream? It was skin-coloured, yeah, dead like a bloody tangerine. Oh, it was terrible. I hated puberty. Then I went out with a girl from the middle-class area of Manchester. You didn't know we had one, did you? Well, I didn't live there. I lived in Lower Crumsall, which was a picturesque spa fishing village. Bank to the River Irk. Well, you could fish for dead dogs, old prams, suicides. Yeah. And this girl lived in Higher Crumsall, where all the middle class lived. And we were in love, that's it. Love knows no boundary of race, creed or class. Long may it be so. And we were in love with each other. I was 17, she was nearly 18. And she met me at a youth club. I was playing a rock and roll band, raunchy little rock and roller. And she must have liked a bit of rough, I don't know what it was, but she was in love with me. And she invited me home. She said, well, going out with her about 2-3 weeks, she said, I want you to come round and meet me mum and dad. I've been telling them all about you, and me mum's dying to meet you. Come on Sunday for your tea. That Sunday, I've got my full teddy boy outfit out, pressed it with the wet cloth. I've got the drain pipes on. I've got the drape jacket. I've got the brothel creepers with the 5-inch soles, you know. I've got the bootlace tie and the skull and crossbones in plastic with the ruby eyes, you know. The cardboard anchor with the 3 points sticking out the top. £4 of brilliantine on the air, all pulled back in a big duck's arse at the back. Big shelf at the front, you know. Peck you to death with it. The Buddy Holly glasses on, Jack the lad, I'm in there, mate. What do you want to make those eyes at me for? If they don't mean to get to the house, I thought, she can't live here. It's too big, it must be an orphanage. People don't live in these. I rang the bell and she came. Ding dong. Oh, she said, I'm so glad you've come. Mummy's dying to meet you. And I went in, and when her mum saw me, she wished she bloody well was dead, I'll tell you. Mouthful of hot tea all over the dog. And for the rest of the time that she knew me, she had a face, every time she saw me, she had a face like a pit bull licking pee off a stinging nettle. And all her dad said was, Now the dog was the real one, because the dog got scalded with all this hot tea. It's having a go at me, isn't it? Having a go under the table at me, because it hates me now. But it has no teeth because it's 17 years old. She's been feeding it on chocolates all its life. Its teeth have rotten out of its head and it's gumming my legs under the table. And I'm having a cup of tea and all you can hear is... She said, it's all right, he can't bite you. He's got no teeth, foo-foo. I said, well, it's hurting. It's hurt. It'll be all right. I got home that night, I'm getting changed. My mum comes in the bedroom. She says, what the bloody hell are you going out with now? A nymphomaniac circus dwarf. But love bites all of my legs. Said, it's a dog. Oh, my God, you're not going out with a dog. Holy Mary. Said, no, it's the girlfriend's dog. Now, this dog is germane to this story. Stick with this dog because it's important. It's pivotal. The dog was a giant poodle, king-sized poodle. You'll have seen them. Massive big versions of those little, crappy, stupid, bloody... Which... No, I know there'll be people in here tonight who've got poodles. Please, don't believe I'm having a go at you. Please, I'm not. But let's be fair, they are not real dogs. Sorry. They are the chicken McNugget of dogs, they are. They're a manufactured dog. Mankind has taken the once noble wolf and by dint of inbreeding over the centuries, he's turned it into something that looks like it should have a toilet roll shoved up his arse and be put on the windowsill in the bathroom. No, they're not real. They're very handy. They're very useful. If you've got one in a car, they use them for getting the condensation off the windows, you know. It's what the bald bit in the middle's for. You've got something to get hold of there. Then when you want to stick it somewhere out of the way, tidy it up, just lick its arse and stick it on the window. Wipe the window for me, please, Mary. Certainly. But the big ones are just neither use nor ornament, useless. So this one's got no teeth, right? 17 years old, this big. Well, with it having no teeth, she couldn't give it proper meat and dog food, so she has to boil mince, really cheap, horrible mince. Boil it for about 4 days till it turns into a runny, gooey, orangey-brown slime. So the dog's been living on this for years and years. It's got alopecia, scurvy, dandruff, there's bits falling off it all the time. So the vet's told her she's got to give it greens to give it vitamins and iron. So she's boiling cabbage for 4 days with loads of bicarbonate of soda to turn that into a green slime. The dog's got bowls of this stuff and it's just sucking it up, going... So it's full of mince, bicarb and cabbage. You don't need A-level chemistry to know what's going on inside that dog. That dog was a danger to low-level aircraft, I'll tell you. It's a danger to shipping. Whenever it walked, there's a permanent green fog following it. Little old ladies dropping over. But they couldn't smell it. The mum and dad, they couldn't smell it. They got no noses, all gone away. The olfactory membranes burnt away like coke sniffers, gone. And I'll tell you, the trouble is, of course, that dogs, when they fart, don't make a noise. You must have noticed this, surely to God. They just sort of go, poot. You know what I mean? It just sort of goes, poot. Well, this girl went away to college, and I used to hitchhike down to see her in Birmingham, where she's at Teachers Training College. And one weekend, she said, my mum and dad are coming on Sunday. They'll give you a lift back in the car. And I thought, oh, no. Because that dog went everywhere with them. Oh, no. I said, no, honestly, I'll walk back, I'll hitchhike back. She said, you can't do that. She said, honestly, I've told them they're expecting you. I thought, oh, God. Because the car, oh, this was brilliant. It was a Morris Minor Traveller. Do you remember them? The half-timbered car. The old English tea shop with a gear stick in the middle. You remember? Just wanted the chintz curtains and the willow pattern cups and saucers. It would have been perfect. So the dog's in the back. It's been fed. Leaving Manchester with mince, cabbage and bicarbonate of soda. It's been jogged up and down all the way down the motorway. Allowed out for a pee in Birmingham and then shoved back in the car and I'm on the back seat. We got as far as Walsall going north and the dog dropped a cracker. I went blind for 3 minutes. That was... Whoa! And both winders are broken on the windows in my compartment. And the dog's behind me giggling, going, hey. I'm on the floor trying to suck air through the crack between the door and the sill. Oh, God, oh, God. And the man looked around and said, what's the matter with you? I've lost my glasses. Oh, God, oh, God. And eventually, after about 7 minutes, I managed to get back up and sit there and the dog going, hey. The other side of Keel Service is going north. The dog did it again. But this time he got what is known in medical parlance as a severe follow-through. Ah! I look round the back of the car, is a lagoon of dog shite swilling about in the back. Oh my God, if he breaks now, Wanaka, this lot's coming through. And nobody said a word. This is what amazed me. Nobody said a word. If that had been Italy, the whole family would have been out on the autostrada. Mamma mia! In Germany, mein Gott in Himmel, du Hund in der Vorsprung, Technik scheißen, mein Frau. Even in Japan, oh, sumo, fumo, naki, sumo, koyaki, oh. Toyota, sumo, naki, oh. But the English middle class, not a word. Nothing. He just drove on, he said, I think we'll pull off at Knutsford, darling. We'll pull off at Knutsford. Let Fufu have a little run. I was going to point out that Fufu just had a mega run in the back of the car. But I thought, keep stum, and I'm sitting there trying to practice Zen Buddhism, you know, the belief that I'm not here. There is no such thing as reality. All of this is unreal, I'm not here. Managed to Knutsford. You should have seen me go when we got to Knutsford. Straight in, three Coca-Colas, one after the other, to take the taste away. And as I'm looking out, I can see her mum and dad cleaning out the back of the car with paper towels and newspaper. And the dog's sitting there going, She goes and gets an air spray, you know, a freshener, and sprays all the inside of the car, so when I get in it now, it smells of lemon-flavoured dog shite. I can't walk, it's 32 miles from Knutsford to our house, so I'm sitting there on the back seat. Dogs in the back compartment going... We pulled off, this is before the M56 was built, we pulled off along the old Cheshire Lanes. It's a beautiful, sunny, summer's Sunday. Cloudless sky, farmers working in the fields all around us, threading our way through the lanes there. I thought, my God, not far to go now. Can manage this. And her dad farted. Again, no noise, but I could tell he was doing it because his neck sort of thickened up, you know, something. And she must have been feeding him on the same stuff she was giving the dog. Because it was rank. I mean, even the dog was going, oh, oh. And he just wound the window down. This is God's honest truth. He wound the window down, looked out at all these farmers and the countryside, and he said, must be the silage, darling. I leaned over, I said, do you eat a lot of it, Mr. Johnson? I'm dancing alone in the night, dear. Tears running down from my eyes. I'm dancing alone and I'm thinking how we said our last goodbyes. I'll never forget how you looked, dear, on the night they took you away. And I'll never forget how you turned, dear, and the tears in your eyes as you said, ba, 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 ba. That's the chorus, you got it? So I'm dancing alone in my cell, dear, looking out at the moon and the stars. And I think of you each time I look, dear, up at those old prison bars. 'Cause I bought you silk stockings and suspenders. Only the best was good enough for you. With your own credit card at Marks and Spencer's. My woolly jumper, how I loved you. Ba, 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 ba. 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 And I told them our love was platonic. As I stood up to give my defense, but I knew, dear, that my case was chronic when the chicken turned Queen's evidence. And I'll never forget what the judge said as he stood to pass sentence on me. He looked across the courtroom at the jury and he led them in sweet harmony. And they all sang, ba, 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 me. Ba, 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 me. Ba, 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 ba. Beautiful. Ba, 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 me. Oh, a song from my puberty called Born Bad. It's a country and western song. And I know that Leeds liners usually love country and western music, and this is the centre of the country and western scene. Well, Batley is, and we're not far from Batley. Anybody here from Batley? Yeah. Ah, great, the tunnel worked then. I knew you'd get out eventually. So especially for you on this. Yeah, it's a country and western song that I wrote myself, recently recorded by a famous country and western singer called Nellie Wilson. Right, Willie Nelson, sorry. You know what I mean. And it's called Born Bad, and you've been so good on the choruses tonight. Me and the lads were talking, seriously. We reckon you're the best chorus singing audience we've had on the whole tour. This is the last night of a 60-night tour, and you are definitely the best we've had on the whole tour. Fantastic. What more can I say? So I won't even insult your intelligence by trying to teach you this. No, I won't. I won't. You know, I'm just going to do it. First time through, I'll do it on my own. Second time through, you'll pick up on it. I know. Third time through, I want you to do it on your own. So you and you alone, it's for you. And then fourth time, we'll all get back together and give it a good rabbit. Okay? So, third time is yours and yours alone. And the song is, like I say, just called Born Bad. Here we go. A one, two, a one, two. Hell yeah. Mm-mm. Heart diggity. Shookins you all. Well, I was too poor to be born, so my mama had me knitted by the WVS. And looking at me now, you know, I think they was a ball of wool short, more or less. My papa was in prison for printing bits of paper with the Queen's head on. And people said, God damn, as I smoked pot, sat in my pram, I was my papa's son. We was so poor that my dog had no legs, and I had to take him out when it was dark. From the wrong side of the tracks, I'd carry him there and back, taking him for a drag in the local park. That was a chorus, you got it? Brilliant. Well, I stole the other babies' bottles, their dummies and their rattles and their chewing bones. I got hooked on teeth and jelly and got busted at the clinic when they found me stoned. When I was five, they made me go to school and all the other children there, they called me names. So I got some plaster of Paris and I put it in their milk and slowed down all their games. We was so poor that my dog had no legs, and I had to take him out when it was dark. From the wrong side of the tracks, I'd carry him there and back, taking him for a drag in the local park. Teacher told me I was no good on the day I chopped the school down with my junior woodman's axe. She didn't like me drinking ink and getting high on plasticine and melted crayon wax. When I was seven, I left home 'cause my girlfriend was in trouble and my dog had bit the priest. With my guitar and my bedroll, I left Oldham bound for Nashville, but my mama told the police. Dragged me up to prison and they left me here a-sitting looking at bars and locks. And my poor old doggie's dead 'cause he had a policeman's leg and choked on one of his socks. And I'm sitting here and I wonder how the hell I come to get me in this mess. And I guess I've gotta blame it on those goddamn knitting needles of the WVS. We was so poor that my dog had no legs, and I had to take him out when it was dark. From the wrong side of the tracks, I'd carry him there and back, taking him for a drag in the local park. I was no good, taking him for a drag in the local park. I was born bad, taking him for a drag in the local
Park.
I'm fascinated by relationships and by the fact that we don't really understand each other, men and women. We believe all sorts of mythologies. We hear all sorts of falsehoods about ourselves and believe them, and about others and believe them. Such statements, for example, as women are the gentler sex. What a load of crap. Ever been to a jumble cell when it's opening on a Saturday morning? Little old ladies with tartan shopping trolleys ramming them into your knees, your crutch. They'd kill for a 35p cardigan and a Bing Crosby album, I tell you. Women are not the gentler sex. Have you ever smacked another woman's child? I had to smack him, Mrs. Robinson. He'd just eaten the head off the cat and I couldn't make him let go. Every mother loves her child, remember that. Even Adolf Hitler's mother loved him. And remember also that to a new mother, her newborn baby is beautiful. All mothers see their babies as beautiful. They have to do. It's this maternal instinct. If they didn't, they'd chuck us all on the rubbish heap. So you look in some prams, and your immediate reaction is to, let's have a look. Let's have a look. Why hasn't he got bolts in the side of his neck? Not be short of a job swinging on the bells at Notre Dame, will he? But you don't say that. You try and say something nice. You know, I can't decide whether he's got, you know, more like you or your Robert. Well, we think he's got his dad's ears. He has, they're in his hands and he's eating them. There's a serial killer in there, you can't see it. This is maternal instinct, this is the way it is. And in that one respect, I think women are ruled by their animal, spiritual nature, whatever you call it. Because in all other respects, I'll say this, and I got a right roasting for this last night, in all other respects, I believe that women are more intelligent than men. Seriously, I mean that. Yeah. You should have seen them in Newcastle, there was a mass walkout of blokes. Why, I'm not having that crap. Come on, I'm going to do there. Got a Brunel, man. Come on. Seriously, I do. I'm not a reconstructed sort of new type man or a new wave alternative comedian, whatever they are. I just have formed this opinion over the years. I'll prove it. Some evidence for you. Women do not stand round in circles singing mucky rugby songs looking as though they've been rounded up by one man and his dog. A woman will not smash your face in for supporting the wrong football team. Women do not play with their willies when they're on the phone. Hello, Tommy. Yeah. Yeah, I'll be down there. I'll come and see you. Yeah, yeah, I'll pick you up. What time? Time of the morning. Yeah, all right, yeah. Women do not think it the height of wit and intelligence to be able to light their farts. Men do. Even Albert Einstein lit his farts, you know. Heinrich, we're getting very close here. E equals MC... Oh, one moment. Good, Nanga. 2 foot long, very good, yeah. MC squared, yeah, we now make the atom bomb. How's about that? Yeah. Women don't. You don't get half a dozen women in the hairdressers under the dryers reading the magazines there. One of them goes, hey, oh, hang up. Hey, up, girls, cop for this. Hey! Oh, that was a belt. I got a bit of blowback. Then I melted me tights. You don't do that. Much more sensible. One thing I don't understand, though, and maybe you sisters can tell me why afterwards, I don't understand why women shave their armpits. God meant you to have hair there. Why are you shaving it? I don't understand. They say, remove unwanted, unfeminine hair. Unfeminine hair? I'm sorry. If you're a woman and it's on you, it's feminine. I'm sorry. It's not giraffe hair, tortoise hair. It's feminine hair. And you probably think I'm weird, you think I'm bent, I'm twisted or whatever else, but I actually happen to like hairy armpits on women. I think they're wonderfully erotic and sexy. All those Italian women on the beaches, oh, beautiful. The other thing I don't understand, waxing the legs. They pay a fortune to lie there in the beauty salon, costs an arm and a leg, and they're lying there, and somebody comes along and pours hot wax over the legs. The stuff they used to pour out of Norman castles on invaders. And they lie there going, oh, go on, go on, ah. And it sets hard and they rip it off. Go on, go on, I look beautiful, go on. If the Gestapo had done that in 1943, they'd have been had up for war crimes, but they pay to have it done. And the other thing, the bikini line. Now, this fascinates me. The bikini line, wax it, rip it off, shave it off, so that they're going bald, other side here. So they can walk on the beach and say, look, see that, bald, see that?
see that, look at that. I can kick a football, yes, I can. I can stand up here, I can move my legs around, look at that, no. Well, I'm sorry, but we all know there's a little powder puff in there, we know. And again, you probably think I'm weird, twisted, strange, but I actually happen to like the two little tufts sticking out either side. Like little Russian anarchists sticking out behind them. I was a founder member of the Tufty Club, I was. In the half ground, get signed in, whoa, yeah. I didn't know it was about squirrels and road safety, I had no idea. When did you see a squirrel driving a truck? No, I actually happen to like them both. No, they've got to go. Shave them off, get rid of them. Oof, gone. Then, they buy false eyelashes and stick them on their eyelids. Why not cut out the middleman and stick your pubes on your eyelids? Oh, what lovely black curly eyelashes you've got, Maury. Oh, there's a touch of your Fred's moustache in there, isn't there? Streak of ginger, I can see that, very nice. Yeah, but in all other respects, they're very, very much more intelligent than men. I mean, men are barmy. How can a man live 25 years with a woman and not know her bra size? But it happens every Christmas. You go to the department store, lingerie department, 20 past five, Christmas Eve, the Legion of the Lost come staggering in, smashed as rats. Into the works, do office party, section party, whatever. They're completely blitzed, gone. Rubber men. Ah, good afternoon, noon evening, madam. Happy Christmas to you too, yes, very nice. What time you close? Oh, really, ah, 10 minutes, right. I'd like to buy some lingerie for the little lady for a present for Christmas. Yes. Pardon my French. I like some black clothes. Ooh, yes, that one on there. Yes, the brassiere with the suspenders and the stockings and the little camisole. Oh, and the French knick. Bye. Certainly, sir. What size is, madam? Size? About this? I don't know. Does it matter? Not if you don't mind bringing them back the day after Boxing Day, so. Ah, what bra size is, madam? Ah, brass. Oh, I know that. About that. Well, my hat covers one of them. Is that any help? Useless. Men are useless. Here's something. This has never got a laugh yet, but I am convinced that this is seriously one of the drollest things. One of the droll. It's not funny. It's droll. Any woman who's ever had to clean a bathroom or a toilet after a bloke will know what I mean by this. How is it that a 7-year-old boy in a weeing competition in school, in the toilets, can get 18 bricks high, no problem? With the accuracy of a cruise missile going through the streets of Baghdad, he'll see a spider on its web in the corner, and with one quick turn and flick, he's got its eye out. Yet he gets to the age of 21, he has a sprinkler fitted on his nudgets all over the floor, the wall. So I'm going to do a song about relationships now, which illustrates all those points we've dealt with in the last 10 minutes or so. And it's called That's What You Are To Me. And it's got a chorus, which I'd love you to join in on. Chorus just goes, That's What You Are To Me. If you don't feel like singing, just mime along with the rest of them. Like the Mekong was to old Dander, like Goldilocks to the Three Bears, like chewing gum in pubic hair, that's what you are to me. Like an umbrella to a duck, like a blank page in a book, like blow football needs a suck, that's what you are to me. 'Cause I need you like a dose of the worms. Thinking about you makes me squirm. Being near you makes me solo. You're the hole in me, Polo. Like a goldfish needs a bicycle pump. Just like Judy was to Punch. Like Quasimodo needed his hunch, that's what you are to me. Like a channel swimmer needs the cramp,
like a house needs rising damp. Florence Nightingale without the blooming lamp. That's what you are to me. 'Cause I need you like a dose of the worms. Thinking about you makes me squirm. Being near you makes me solo. You're the hole in me, Polo. Like Adam and Eve needed the fruit. Like a penguin needs a tube of glue. Like a vindaloo fart in a diving suit. That's what you are to me. Like a mist bus on a rainy night. Like a Christmas tree without the lights. Like making love without taking off your tights. That's what you are to me. You're as fresh as last year's socks. As funny as a dose of the whooping cough. If I didn't love you so much, I'd bugger off. But I love you, you crab-faced, moaning, mithering. What time you call this coming round here? Pick up your feet while I hoover underneath. You're gonna have to talk to that lad of yours, you know. Meh. 'Cause like Corky the cat was to the dandy, just like Mahatma was to Gandhi, just like Fergie was to Andy. That's what you are to me. That's what you are to me. That's what you are to me.
Yeah, I would like to do for you now my 8th symphony for mouth organ and breath. Yeah, I mean, not many people know I've written 8 symphonies, but I have. This is Opus 97 in E-flat major, and it starts off, it's 2 movements. Obviously, most symphonies have a few movements within them. And this has 2, 1 andante and 1 allegro furioso, and the andante is slow, and the allegro furioso is fast, as you probably know that. And it's based on the works of a guy called Sonny Terry, who was Mozart's cousin, and who run a fish and chip shop in Chapel Town Road. Listen, do you take bugger all serious in this place? I don't mean... Sonny Terry was a brilliant symphonic harmonicist, and he did a wonderful thing called the fox chase, on which he made all the noises of the fox hunt on a little mouth organ no bigger than that. He did the horns blowing in the morning, calling the huntsman too, going... And you hear all the dogs getting excited and yelping and woofing, going... And then they chase this fox all over the mountains, and then eventually catch the poor old fox and kill him. And the last thing you'd hear in the piece of music would be the old daddy fox dying on the mountainside, crying out as he died, going... Honey, I can't do that, so instead... I will do something called the cop chase, because we don't get many foxes in Manchester, you see. And the cop chase happens on a Saturday night after the pubs have shut in most of our cities. And the Legion of the Damned turn out. The Midnight Mechanics. They're absolutely bloated on Tetley's Best Bitter. They're absolutely smashed. They become the rubber men walking on the marshmallow pavement. You know the sort. Jimmy, Tommy, am I right or what? You having it or what? I'll put you there, pal. Do me, Fred. I see you then, my pal. See you, my mate. Yeah, you're like, you know, wobbling down the pavement. And they suddenly decide they want some fish and chips. So they open the chip shop door, go in. You hear all this in the music, by the way. There's no commentary. It's a little like Peter and the Wolf, this, you know. You know, Prokofiev. It's a bit like Peter and the Wolf. And there's no Peter and there's no Wolf. So it's called And. Anyway. They go into the chip shop, and they order fish, chips and mushy peas twice, get loads of salt and vinegar on it, and pay the guy, ding, and out they go, walking down the pavement, shut the door, down the pavement, eating these fish and chips, but they're that full of beer. They can't possibly finish them, so they throw them away behind them. Now, this is when the second movement begins, because it lands on the windscreen of a police patrol car with 2 bogies in it, and all of a sudden there's a lot of allegro furioso going on, because these policemen would like to discuss with these 2 chaps who've just covered their windscreen with cod and batter and mushy peas. You know, a few things about litter and things like that. So off they go, these two geezers, running like the clappers in the police cars, with the blue light going round. These two blokes turn right, and the police car follows them. You hear it in the music. They turn right. You cynical buggers. Is this what 13 years of Tory misrule has done to you? You mistrust a poor journeyman mouth organ player like me. I'm carrying on. They turn right, then they turn straight down this road. They're going like clappers down the road, and the police are after them. And they go down a little ginnel, a really narrow back alleyway. Police car gets jammed, eek, in the, you know, back alleyway. The guys can't get out because, of course, the doors are jammed in. And the two fellas run down, going na 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 na. Oh no, pride cometh before the fall, because as soon as they get to the bottom of that entry, there's another police car they've radioed ahead with four bogies inside it, and there then follows a little party political broadcast on behalf of the very violent party. And there's a little discussion of a physical nature, basically, yes you did, no we didn't, yes you did, no we didn't, yes you did, and then a few bits of knuckle butty and clog pie. And the last thing you hear, the coda, the end of the symphony, the last thing you hear is a wonderful denouement. You hear the mum crying in court the next morning as the two blokes get sent down. It's all there in the music. Anyway, I don't need to explain anymore. It's all there. Here we go. The cop chase. You may have noticed during the course of this evening's performance that I've developed the uncanny ability of being able to sing close harmony with myself. Well, this was purely accidentally. I only discovered this because I had a peculiar throat problem. I'd noticed when I was singing in the bath that all these harmonies were coming out. I went to see the doctor because I've always had a rough old throat. Like, you know, I don't sort of sing so much as shout in tune, you may have noticed. So I went to see the doctor and I said, "What is it, doc?" I said, "I've got this real weird thing in my throat." He said, "Let's have a look." He looked down, he said, "Fantastic. Incroyable, unbelievable." He said, "You've got quins." I said, "You mean like quinsies, like septic tonsils?" He said, "No, quins. When your mother was having you, the egg split into five, you grew to maturity." He said, "But amazingly, you've got four little brothers, teeny weeny, incy, wincy." You cynical buggers. All right, all right. Me and my brothers now, me and our kids, we're going to do a five-part barbershop harmony. Right, lads? That one we're rehearsing this afternoon, we're going to do it, fellas. Okay. You ready, Tom?
Yes.
Eric?
Yes.
Sid?
Yes.
Fred?
Yes.
Right.
Barber shop. Barber shop. Where I went to get my hair cut. The barber I remember, his name it was Frank. I was only little, so he sat me on a plank. He cut my hair while I sat there. Frank, he was my friend. Though I was only seven, I'd have been in seventh heaven if he'd asked me if I wanted anything for the weekend. Ba 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 boom.
Yeah.
I want to do a 300-year-old folk song for you now that I wrote myself a couple of weeks back. And seriously, I started off playing in rock and roll and then graduated into folk clubs and grew to love British folk music because mainly of its narrative content, because folk songs always tell stories, and such wonderful stories too. Stories about drowned sailors, mermaids, whaling fleets, people being press ganged, people going to the Crimean War and being blown to pieces, shipwrecks, people being transported to Botany Bay, poachers, highwaymen. Fantastic stories, you know, and I thought, great, I want to do some folk songs for you. But I realised that in a 3-hour one-man show, you know, it's very difficult for me to do. You do realise that I'm in, by the way, do you? This is not a support act. I just got some blank looks then. It frightened me first. Now, there's no Enrico and his whistling ferrets tonight. It's just me. No Madame Griselda's trombone dwarfs. This is the main event, you know. So long as you know, frighten the crap out of me for a second then. No, so I decided what it'd be nice to do is one song with everything in. So I call it a sort of K-Tel folk song. Get fluff off your jacket with it as well. No. So, I'd like to do it for you now, but just tell you two things which you do need to know about folk music. Every so often I will go, nyah! When I do that, it's not a stylistic device by which I sort of help the tune along or anything like that. It just means I've forgotten the words. And also, every time I come to a long word, I will stick extra syllables in so that it helps the scheme of the rhythm, you know, sort of the words like England will become Ingiland, and Australia will become Australia, and walking will become Wallaking, and encyclopedia becomes book. Right, that's all you need to know, really. So, the K-Tel folk song, which will help you to get fluff off your jackets and educate yourself at the same time. Nyah, oh nyah, oh nyah, oh come all ye rambling accountants and listen to me story. 'Tis only 1,000 verses long and I'm sure it will not bore ye. As I roved out one May morning in Woolyworths to get some elastic bands, as I roved past the pick and mix, I was jumped on by a press gang. Oh, for 40 days our ship was tossed, all in the Bay of Biscay. The crew was tossed and the captain was tossed. Yeah. I was sick myself in the ashtray,
Then we landed on Crimea shore, and in no time at all, I lost an arm and leg of me Sony personal stereo with the help of a big cannonball. Oh, I was sent back to Ingailand and was constrained to beg, 'cause there's not much call for a Bow Street runner that's only got one leg. Me and four more out poaching went into Lord Scrotum's park, and caught we was by gamekeepers, we should have gone in the dark. Transported we was to Botany Bay on far Australia shore, but I disguised myself as a gananganangaroo and jumped ship at Krakatoa. I was lying down and having a kip there upon the sands, when a big volcano went biff bang crack, it went off in me hand. Oh, I was blown up into the air and right across the briny. I got up so high I could see the sun, it was big and shiny. Then me progress, it reversed itself, because the air was very steep, and I fell back down as fast as I'd went and landed in the deep. Oh, I was just about to die from breathing water, when to my surprise I was escorted to the surf, I guess, by a pretty mer I made. I was picked up by a whaling fleet and in search of whales did go. Oh, I told them it was next to Ingailand, but they didn't want to know. They said them whales was very enormous fish. I said I thought that was most courageous. The captain said he'd once caught Moby Dick. I said I hoped it wasn't contagious. Yeah. Then I found myself adrift at sea when the ship hit a 9-inch nail, and I was just about to start eating myself when I was eaten myself by a whale. Oh, for 40 days I roamed the earth in Leviathan's old belly. I must admit I've had better lodgings and some that weren't quite so smelly. I decided to escape by rolling myself up in a ball and giving him constipation. There was a bang and a crack and I shut out of the back in the middle of Blackpool illuminations. And 'twas there I met my own true love, the milkmaid, as I was a-wallocking on the sands. She was hiding in her little tent with a Punch and Judy on her hands. I crept in up behind the tent, so quiet she would not know it, and I put a smile on her crocodile, saying, "That's the way to do it." So come all ye rambling wheelbarrow designers, and warning take by me, don't spend your money on women and wine when you haven't got any. And here's a bit of old advice, what I learnt from an optimist: always remember a bird in the hand does it on your wrist. Yeah. Take a bow, lads, take a bow. Well, I'm going to finish now. This is my last number because I get fed up after a bit. I've got another booking after this anyway. It's in December sometime. I want to finish with a song about raw, unadulterated lust. Sex. I'm fascinated by the fact that we are the only animals that get embarrassed about sex. You know, we are. We're the only animal that has a Mary Whitehouse. Seriously. I find this phenomenal. Dogs don't have a Mary Whitehouse. Dogs just do it anywhere. They don't get embarrassed. No, oh, dog sees another dog. Oh, hello, Fufu. On eat, are we? Turn around then. Very simple, yeah. Even your sparrow, he don't get embarrassed. Peck, 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 peck. Peck, 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 peck. Oh, I feel like a jump. Whoop, thank you. Peck, 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 peck. Yeah. And it's easy for animals to express their sexuality, I've got to admit this, yeah, it's a lot easier. Like your peacock, you know, he can show off, he can get his sort of big feathers up there and he can fan them out and go, "How about that then, girls? Are you having that or what? Are you having it? Are you having it? Eh? Is that the full Monty or is it not? Eh? Do you live with your parents? Yeah? Come back for a coffee or what? Are you having that, eh? They're better than a Porsche, isn't it, that? Better than a Porsche? Yeah, even the pavement pecking pigeon
Even he can do something. He can go, brucko, 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 brucko. You can't. Well, you can, but it'll get you nowhere. Not even in the Grove or the Adelphi or Leeds Brig, you know, nothing like that. No, we can't. We've got nothing we can do. Women are better at it than men. Women are better at emphasising their sexuality in order to attract men. They've got brassieres they can wear, push stuff out and up, and they wear lipstick and makeup and stockings and suspenders and all that sort of stuff, you know. Men, nothing. Nothing. In the Middle Ages, we did. Middle Ages, we had something called the codpiece. We could wear a codpiece in them days. The codpiece, you probably read about it in the history books. It was a sort of padding thing that emphasised the penile hump, you know. Sort of stuck it all out. I mean, you get some of them were like 2 foot long. Smack kids on the head with them. Behave yourself! Smack, you know, bloody get hold of you, man. Blah. Knock an apple off a barrel when you're walking. Oh, did he? But. I thought it'd be great to revive that, you know, as a fashion point, seeing yourself in sort of Q magazine and all the rest of it, you know, and I thought, I'd do this, you know, I'll have a codpiece. I couldn't get any cods, so I got a pair of kippers and shoved them down the front. At the undivided attention of 58 Tomcats, it was quite strange. Yeah. But men are generally rubbish at it. We have not got the technology. We've not got it together. Women are much better than us. They've got it all sorted. When it comes to sexuality, they make the running. Believe you me. And I tell you what, they know it. They wear all the right stuff. They know it. But it's also, I've got to admit, I mean, you probably think I'm weird. You probably think I'm twisted because of the Tufty Club business. But I tell you, I think there's nothing more erotic and beautiful when you're in a relationship. I'm not talking about striptease. There's nothing more beautiful and erotic than watching your lady getting undressed at night. That gradual exposition, that gradual unveiling of all that feminine beauty, the little flimsy things falling off, you know, there's dropping to the floor, and then there's the beautiful shapes and contours and the heaviness and smoothness of the skin. It's been a bloody long tour, I'll tell you that for nothing. I went for a minute then. I was sorry about that. I mean, you know what I mean? I mean, it is sensuous, it's beautiful, it's erotic, all those things. Beautiful and erotic at the same time. You can't say that about a bloke getting his kit off. I'm sorry. There is nothing faintly erotic about a bloke wandering round in a grubby pair of wide fronts and a vest. Particularly if he's left his socks on. And he's wobbling round the bedroom, scratching his bum, looking for what karaoke magazine. I put it down here somewhere. You've shifted it. No. Men's underwear is a big no-no. It is a big turn-off. I'm sorry about that. It is. I mean, in particular, string underwear. If there's anybody here who wears string underwear, seriously, because I know you can still buy it at Greenwoods and places like that, you know, together with your flat hats, but seriously, if you wear string underwear, go home tonight, burn them. Burn them. Particularly string underpants. You should not wear string underpants. Mm-mm. Because your willy looks like a trout in a keep net. Ridiculous. Couldn't do it. There's a woman nudging her husband over that, I told you. Men are last. Honestly, we should hold our hands up and just give up. We are last. Men are rubbish. Men are useless. Foreplay. Men are useless at foreplay. They think it's just a matter of grabbing all the things and squeezing them. That's all you do. And if it lasts more than 2.5 minutes, the mind wanders, they're all over the place. I wonder if the car will start in the morning. I should have put some newspaper on the windscreen. I know I should have spent it flushed. I'll have to get that bloke from next door to me hand shoving it, and I hate the bastard. I never like being beholden to it. Oh, look at that. That moth's going to burn itself on that lamp in a minute. Useless. I tell you what, you do get some men who try, fair play, you get some men who do try. They take a day off from work, they send the kids to the grandma's, and they cook a beautiful meal while it's cooking. They vacuum the house top to bottom, clean it all, do all the washing in, the dryer, do all the business there, the ironing. The wife comes home at night, there's a four-course cordon bleu meal, candlelit dinner, bottle of Rioja breathing on the table there. Fires lit, logs, flames, beautiful, fantastic candlelit dinner. He takes her coat off, sits her down, massages her feet while she's drinking the gin and tonic with ice and lemon. He's just given her. He leads her to the table, sits her down, pecks her lightly on the cheek, sits around in front of her, pours a glass of red wine for her and one for himself, and he says, "My love, here's to you, and here's to us." And she says, You bought that bloody motorbike, haven't you?
I know you want.
It doesn't matter even if you did try, because you're still basically rubbish at it. That is the way we are. I tell you, it's largely through ignorance. A lot of it is through not knowing, through being ignorant. And I hate this ignorance. I think it's important we should talk about stuff. This is why I hate Mary Whitehouse's attitude towards life and love and sex. We should talk about, discuss these things. There'll be blokes in here tonight, seriously, who won't even know how to find the clitoris. Seriously. Oh, we got a few hens bums then? Oh, we got... What do you think? Let me out, quick, let me out. What did he say then? Listen, madam, you might know where it is. There's blokes here from Otley, Batley, Dewsbury, Wakefield. I haven't got a clue. It's important we talk about... I don't want nobody going in ignorant tonight. I'm going to tell you exactly where it is. It's in the knife drawer. Yeah. For years. With the egg whisk and the corkscrew at the back of the... Important that I had a mate of mine. Seriously, he was hard of hearing anyway, but he didn't even know what one was. So he's got a new girlfriend. He thought, oh, I'll ask her, you know. I mean, this was a step in itself, like, you know. She said, if there's anything that you'd like me to do, you know, just tell me, like, you know what I mean? So she told him. And he couldn't hear properly. He thought she said, play with me licorice. So he got up and went off. She thought, where the bloody hell's he gone? She got a dressing gown on, went downstairs. This is true. He sat at the kitchen table making a house out of Pontefract cakes. Is it good for you, darling? It's important we talk about this stuff. I'm telling you, we should not go home ignorant. We should discuss it. It's important we talk. Things like oral sex. Oral sex is dark and lonely work, but somebody has to do it. It's like coal mining. The view's limited, I'll give you that. The view's limited. But I believe now you can get transfers that you can stick on all over the place into the back of it. Taj Mahal by moonlight, you know. Otley Shevin, things like that, you know. But if you do decide to try oral sex, you never tried it before, if you wear contact lenses, let me tell you, take them out first. Get them lost in the pubes, the game's over, Charlie. Yeah, it's important we talk about this kind of stuff. Men and women are very different, you know. Women will talk about it. They'll talk about their worries and their fears and concerns heart to heart. Very, very open women. Not men. No, no. When it comes to sex, men are either telling mucky stories or boasting about it. 15 times last night. Crap. I'm telling you, 15 times. 15 times. He is, in fact, telling the truth. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Another woman just nudged her husband over there. But women, they talk about it. Seriously. Group of women together. Oh, I don't know what yours is like. That one of mine, he's barmy. He's getting worse. He don't get better as he gets older. He gets worse. Oh, I don't know who's putting him up to it. Whether his mates are talking to him about it, I don't know. Or he's reading too many books. I'm going to rip up his library tickets. I'll tell you that for nothing. I'm lying in bed last night, knitting. And he said... He said, you know what he said? I said, what? He said, I said, you want me to what? You want me to... You're not on, Charlie. I don't even like Cumberland sausage and I can slice that. You might be. Oh, God, and they're so proud of them out the way. Till I tell you, they're so proud. They think they're the only ones who've got on me. Wanders around the bedroom with it stuck out, swanning around like that. I threw me hat on it. I said, oopla, give me a teddy off the top shelf. It's important we discuss things. As human beings, we've got to discuss things. If I embarrass you, by the way, tell your friends, they'll come next time. Don't worry about it. It's only life. I talk about life. It's true. I was brought up in ignorance. Seriously, Irish Catholic household, I knew nothing. In fact, I'll tell you something, this will surprise you. I started this tour 10 weeks ago, 60 concerts. Very first night, I found out, I didn't know till then, you can buy flavoured condoms. I didn't know that. Flavoured condoms. Who the hell invented flavoured condoms? The man who invented boiling the bag lettuce, I assume. What do you do with them? Do you chew them if she doesn't turn up? Oh, she's not here, right, that's it. And how do you know what flavour you want?
A pint of Guinness, bottle of baby sham, and a packet of cheese and onion flavoured condoms, please, Frank.
Sorry, what did you say, Mary? Oh, smoky bacon, I forgot you like smoky. When you read the packs, I tell you what, that's an education in itself. Read the packet. Because lovemaking is such a wonderful and tender experience. Because lovemaking is so much being together, and togetherness is so much part of lovemaking. Let your partner put the condom on for you. Don't even bloody consider it. Have you seen them putting on marigold washing up gloves?
Inga, 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 inga. Inga, 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 inga.
Oh. You do get... You do that, Charlie, the game's a bogey. It's over, it's finished with. No. But if you do decide, seriously, I mean, we should talk about this. If you do decide that this is for you, this form of contraception or whatever is for you, then the first time you ever use one, do it in a practice run, on your own, somewhere. Quiet room, dim lighting, cup of tea, some nice music on the record player. Take it out, examine it, practice with it, chug it away, that's it. Because if you use one for the first time when you're all soused up and all erotic and aroused and firing on 10 cylinders, you know, cooking with gas, and you're twitchy and you're in a hurry and it's all rush and it's fantastic and you don't want it to go off the boil, and you've had a few drinks and you get it the wrong way round, and if you get it the wrong way round, it will not go on because it will only roll on one way. You get it the wrong way round, it's like trying to get a tea cosy over an elephant.
No!
I'll be with you in a minute.
No! I'm dying, oh shit!
And you're rocking the bed to keep it going. Oh, you're... You can't find it, so you get another one out. And this one, 50-50 chance, goes on okay, no problem. And you're making love. The most wonderful thing that two people, three, four, I don't mind, two people can do together. And it's wonderful, it's fantastic. You go, yes, oh, yes, oh, yes, oh, yes, oh, yes. Can you smell burning rubber? And you look, and it's stuck on the light bulb, sizzling. It's important we talk about stuff like this, I tell you. If you do decide to use the condom, it's for you. You buy them in bulk, keep them in the fridge because they go off if they get warm. But remember to return them to room temperature first. Because your little friend does not like getting cold.
Here I am, okay, ready, ready, ready. Oh, God, it's freezing. Not playing now.
No, you might decide that's not for you, fair enough. But the pill, I could never get on with the pill. Ooh, terrible trouble with the pill. I couldn't get it to balance properly on the end. You know, you get... Oh, it's fell off again. Give us another one of them, hadn't it? Well, the cap's something awful, I don't know, you know. Men don't understand this, but, you know, the cap is terrible. It's a bit like... Well, the best way for a man to understand it, it's like making love with a frisbee up your bum. And they're horrible, they're really awkward little things. You've seen them, they're a little dog. I should have brought one with me to show you. It's, you know, without visual aids, it's difficult, this. It's a little rubber dome like that with a spring all the way around it, and you've got to squeeze the spring in to get it in position, all the rest of it, you know. And you have to put, what's his name, spermicidal cream in it too. Spermicide, you know, comes from the two Greek words, spermicide. I mean, to kill sperm, like suicide means to kill Sue, and regicide means to kill Reg. You know, put this in it and that kills. She said, it's not a poison, you know. People thought it was a poison. It's not a poison. They slip in it and break the necks.
Oh! Watch out, fellas, watch out! Too late.
Yeah. But that makes it slippy, really, of course, as you know, so you get together and then... That's what all these crop circles are down south, you know. Nothing to do with UFOs and aliens. People in parked cars, okay, well,
terrible amount of ignorance in the world, a terrible and heinous amount of ignorance going on. Many people don't even know, for example, that condoms were first invented as musical instruments. That's what they were. They were played, the Condomo brothers, Umberto and Luigi. Umberto and Luigi Condomo, the next village to the Stradivarius brothers, they used to have condom bands going all over Italy. Right, I'll bloody show you, you don't believe me. This is just an ordinary one, it's not a special one. I got this out of the machine tonight, in the gents. I'll show you, you cynical lot. This is... We got a few ends bums over there now. What's he doing with that? What's he doing with that? It's all right, madam, you're safe. It'll be a while before I get up there. You're okay. 10 rows to go through before you. You're all right, relax. No, they used to play these all over Italy. He played his old condomo, you know. Yeah, I don't know who thought of putting one on his willy for the first time. What a damn pot idea. It's like having a fiddle on your willy, isn't it? You know. Oh, well, there you go. But I'll show you. I'll show you how to play a tune on one. You've got to stretch it a lot first, and then you double it up over like that. I was going to do this on Blue Peter, but they wouldn't let me. They said they wanted to make a spaceship out of yogurt cartons, you know, and cheese packets before. So I'll get... Don't do it now. Wait till you get home. There's always one in there. Put it away, you balmy bugger. You'll have somebody's eye out with it. Right? You twirl it up like that, so it's sort of a... And you make a sort of twangy noise with it, you know, and you catch it between your teeth. And what I'll do, I'll show you how to do this, and we can all sort of join in later on, perhaps. I'll show you. And what you do is you double it over, and then you catch it, and I'll play some tunes for you. I'll start off with, let me just think, Wee Willy Winky, that always goes well. Then I'll do Johnny Be Good, and Coming Through the Rye, and then we'll do I've Lost That Loving Feeling, the Pointer Sisters, remember that one, and we'll finish off with Cock of the North. How's that? Smashing, here we go. Oh, sorry, I got a lot of wit back then. It was, oh, bloody salt and vinegar flavour and all I ate then. Watch you don't slip in that later, tell me when you come. Oh, you've got the idea anyway, you've got the gist of it now, because what we're going to do for this last song, which is a love song, we're going to pass condoms along the rows. We've not got enough for one each, but about one in four, and they're all in E-flat minor, which is the key that I'm playing in this, so get them out and twang along. I've shown you how to do it. Now, don't worry about making a fool of yourself. You know, it's all right. It's a nice end of the night. You get it all going, lovely chorus. So if you don't feel like, or if you've not got a condom to twang along, then you can clap in time, because it's a Russian love song, a Cossack love song, and all that sort of Cossack clapping business, you know, you can do that. It's a Cossack's farewell to his horse. And anybody here from Batley, if you use two hands for the clapping, you'll find it a lot more successful, you know. Yeah. Here we go. The song's called Yada Giveros Porotsky Nieti Kartari Klasir Novgorod Novgorod Saimov Dupa Starakrova. Yeah. Beautiful old song. For I want you to imagine the Russian steps and then the pavement and the windows and things like that. And we'll have a do. Bloody slippy stuff that, isn't it? I tell you, it's all over. At least my fingers won't get pregnant. Comrade Olga, nit, 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 nit. She can be vulgar, nit, 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 nit. When she wants to be, nit, nit, nit. This pretty miss kissed Ivan Ivanovich in the tractor factory, nit, 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 nit. She put her hand inside his Bolsheviks, nit, 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 nit. And tickled Ivan's balalaikas, nit, 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 nit. Comrade Olga, get your chuskies off. Down with the bourgeoisie, hoi, hoi, hoi. Comrade Olga, get your chuskies off. Olga, be bugger with me, I am. Comrade Olga, she was married to Boris Pizdov. He was not happy that his Olga liked to Trotsky off. And since Boris had muscles in his urals, Ivan Ivanovich kept his balalaikas to himself. Ay, 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 comrade Olga, get your chuskies off. Down with the bourgeoisie, hoi, 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 comrade Olga, get your chuskies off. Olga, be vulgar with me, ay, ay. Comrade Olga said to Ivan Ivanovich, my Boris, he works nights, nit, 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 nit.
Do you not think, ski, that a drink, ski, at my flat, ski, would be nice? It's not risky. I have some whiskey and some ice. So my chook, ski, let's get drunk, ski, tonight. Aye, 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 comrade Bulger, give the Tuskies off. Come with the bourgeoisie, hoi, 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 comrade Bulger, get the Tuskies off. Olga, he Bulger, with me, aye, aye. So comrade Olga and Ivanovich, they got Dronsky's Newtskis. Chiovsky, Thruski, all her clothskis, and her sockskis and bootskis. And as the moonlight flitted across her minarets, the fluff all blew off Ivan's balalaikas. Comrade Olga, get the Trotskys off. Down with the bourgeoisie, hoi, hoi, hoi. Comrade Olga, get the Trotskys off. Olga, be Olga with me, aye, aye. Just then, ski, there was a knock, ski, at the front door bell, ski. Ivan had tremblings in his Kremlins, whispered bloody hell, ski. As through the door, Boris, he came kicking, Dovich, under the bed, ski. Ivanovich did go, whoa, whoa, whoa. Comrade Olga, get your Trotskys off. Down with the bourgeoisie, hoi, hoi, hoi. Comrade Olga, get your Trotskys off. Olga, leave Olga with me, I am. Now when Boris saw his Olga in the Nutskis to ski, Iovski threw ski all his clothskis as fast he could ski, and across onto the bed ski, did it go ski, as underneath lay Ivan Ivanovich with his head stuck in the pole ski. Comrade Olga, get the Trotskys off. Down with the bourgeoisie, hoi, hoi, hoi. Comrade Olga, get the Trotskys off. Olga, be Olga with me, aye, aye. Now poor Ivanovich had his nose ski stuck in the bed spring skis. Every bump ski of the bed ski made his head ski against the post ski ring ski. And as the bed ski got fastaski and fastaski and fastaski and fastaski, as it does ski, if you're lucky ski, it sounded like the Moscow fire alarm ski. Comrade Olga, get your Trotskys off. Down with the bourgeoisie, hoi, hoi, hoi. Comrade Olga, get your Trotskys off. Olga, be Olga with me, aye, aye. There's a red ski under the bed ski, Boris loudly cried. I am pissed off. I don't like it either, Ivanovich replied. But just then ski and ski came, and the Moscow fire brigade ski, and soaked everybody with their hot ski pipe skis. Aye, 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 comrade Olga, get your Trotskys off. Down with the bourgeoisie, hoi, hoi, hoi. Comrade Olga, get your Trotskys off. Olga, be Olga with me, aye, 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 aye. Mm-hmm. Oh, to the salt mines, Boris and Ivan were sentenced to Vich. 14 years, ski, for a false fire alarm, ski. What a son of a bitch. But comrade Olga, she does not give a bloody Vostok, cause every night, ski, she rattles the post key. And to her flat, the fire brigade, ski, goes, ski. And she blows the fluff of all their balalaikas. Comrade Olga, get the Trotskys off. Down with the bourgeoisie, hoi, hoi, hoi. Comrade Olga, get the Trotskys off. Olga, be Olga with me, aye, aye. Comrade Olga, get the Trotskys off. Down with the bourgeoisie, hoi, hoi, hoi. Comrade Olga, get the Trotskys off. Olga, be Olga with me, aye, aye. Aye, 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 aye. Tabanich, that's your lot.
Thanks for giving me such a cracking night. Thank you. Good night, God bless Leeds. See you.
You know, when those gal boat tick down, we go and we horse around with them good time girls in the house of Mucky Peg. When Auntie Kitty found Uncle Fred, he spent 18 months in bed, because you can't run fast with your pants halfway down your legs. Sardina cowboy in Rochdale. Spurs don't fit right on my gloves. Sardina cowboy in Rochdale. Cause people laugh when I ride fast on our station door.